thank you for this opportunity to be here and to share some ideas with you. My talk is about Invent in India with DIY, and I partition the talk informally in three parts: the larger motivation and the justification, followed by why invent in India, and the DIY part at the end. I brought a couple of demonstrations. I'm not used to speaking to a fixed plan. Usually as a teacher, I would love to go on and on. And so I seek your forgiveness to begin with, at the beginning itself, if I overshoot the time or I finish much earlier than I am expected to. What is the motivation to be doing all these things? I think the motivation is me. As René Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. And so I am the center of this universe. You are the center of your universe. If you don't exist, the universe doesn't exist. And so if you are doing something for your benefit, for your happiness, for your success, in whatever way happiness, seek that gratification at the cost of others, or by denying it to others, is a problem area. So if you think you want to be, you are the center of this universe and you want to do things, great, right? So what is this happiness about? This happiness has two components. One is the physical happiness that you derive out of material things, food, shelter, clothing, and other things of entertainment. And the other is the fact that you will derive emotional happiness if you find that people around you are also happy. Because we live in this world in a hierarchical fashion. I am the center of the universe. I am surrounded by my family, my neighbors, my society, my city, my country, and then this universe, this nation, this earth. And so if I start by making myself happy, it would help me being happier if I find that I'm able to solve the problems of fellow citizens. And this is where invention comes and plays some role. I'm going to show you something to begin with. This is a toy I bought a couple of years ago. This is by a toy store called Hamleys. Hello, say hello to all the people assembled here. You may have heard of this app on phone called Talking Tom. This is the hardware version of it. And this is by this company called Hamleys. You may have seen many stores of Hamleys coming up in metropolitan cities of India. And my question is, are we looking at East India Company Part 2? All right. And I will reserve my answer to this question, and I will share it with you later when I end my talk. So the reason why me as the center of this universe seeking happiness and for sharing my happiness with people around me by looking at their problems. So India right now is a great place to be, because when you say you want to make others happy, it would be through many ways. You try to reduce hunger, you try to reduce their poverty, you try to make them live, enable them to live a life of dignity. And all these things can be achieved by solving their problems, and which is where this inventing solutions to problems comes and plays a role. And why did I show this toy? Because if you see what are we as a nation been doing in the last 70 years towards that end, if you see almost everything that we use after we wake up till the time we go to bed or even while we are sleeping, you would see that almost everything is not made in India, that most of it is imported. Can you think of an Indian name assigned to a world-class product?
Tata Motors.
Okay. I would think that Tata Motors is one of hundreds of other automotive companies, but one name which stands out, and I feel very great pride in recalling that, is a name called Bose. How many of you have heard the name Bose? Bose is Bose speakers. and they brought out revolutionary, this audio systems, something called noise cancelling technology and all that. And this is an Indian name. It's a different matter that this gentleman did not grow up in India or this invention did not happen in India. But the fact is that that is probably one of a very few names associated with an Indian that is known worldwide. But apart from that, we are sorely lacking any manufacturing or creative activity in all the things that we use every day. And this is not good for we as a nation, because happiness also, as I mentioned, we are talking of dignity. And when we see that everything that we use from the time we wake up to the time that we sleep, everything we have to depend on others for our survival, this hurts our dignity. And 70 years since independence, it is probably high time that we address it. How do we go about doing this? And why is it a great time to be in India to be doing that invention? Because if we look around, we see there are problems and problems with everybody. Farmers are small, marginal farmers are facing issues with their crop. They are not able to do farming in a sustainable fashion. We find youth seeking education, and after education they are almost unemployable because they don't have any skills. We look at the strategic requirements of this country, and for everything we have to go out, whether it is defense or whether it is high technology trains. And so if you want to invent, the first requirement of invention is that you should be able to identify a problem. And if this country has so many problems, this should be the prime place where people should flock, and they do. It's a different matter that our own youth, after finding education, after getting education, they try to see greener pastures. On the other hand, I find people from the Western societies actually coming here trying to look at problems so that they could create solutions and then sell those solutions to you. So if India is beset with problems, I would find that this is a great place to invent. What are the other things required? That once you look at a problem, you would probably create a better notion of that problem, and then try to find a mechanism, a mental mechanism to solve that problem. And eventually you would need what is called as a proof of concept. And this is where this ability to do things with your own hands, to actually create prototypes, that is very important, and that is sorely lacking in our society, for historical reasons that we have partitioned our society in four or five different ways, and we assign the task of doing things with hands only to a certain section of society. This may have worked well in the past, but today in 21st century, this is not going to be of any use, because when you go and look at your competition, there is no Brahmin, there is no Kshatriya, there is no Shudra. A Chinese is a Chinese. He doesn't care what he is. He would do everything that is required of him to start with an idea, create a prototype, convert it into a product, and market it. And unless we also assume that role, it will be tough for us. We will remain perpetual consumers all the time, trying to get the things that we need by selling our skills in different ways, rather cheaply, which is what is happening in this country, that a major foreign exchange earner is a business process outsourcing that doesn't require very high skills, right? So we had to break those stereotypes that only certain kind of people will work with their hands. We, as maybe somebody else, will not do that. And actually, I see this happening all the time. The other day, my wife teaches physics in one of the Delhi University colleges. She's part of some team which is supposed to make sure that there is order in the college. She found that certain students were misbehaving. They were brought to that committee, and they said, okay, instead of assigning a fine, some monetary fine, let us make them do something. So they said, okay, clean the sinks in the chemistry lab. And these kids refused. And I said, why? I said, it's very humiliating. Why is cleaning the sinks that you are yourself going to use, why is cleaners humiliating? Because they find that the activity of cleaning is only assigned to a certain section of society. That I, as a literate person, I, as an educated person, is not supposed to do it. And this is completely wrong. One of the reasons why Western countries invent is because they assign a lot of value to human labor, which makes it very difficult for common people to afford the services of other humans. And so they have to naturally find a way to automate that process. And this is where they end up inventing something. And this is all provided because of the culture they follow called DIY, do it yourself. We, on the other hand, in India, we follow something quite contrary. I call it DDIY, don't do it yourself. And the reason is we don't do it yourself is because there's no need. Labor is so cheap in this country that I don't need to do it myself. And if I'm not doing it myself, I as an educated or a technically competent person will not have an opportunity to use my skills to find a technical solution to that problem. Why? Because it can be done cheaply. You look at how I can get my car washed every day for 300 rupees a month, right? If this was to be paid 10 or 20 times what I am currently paying, I would surely find some solution which is scalable, which is affordable, and which does not depend on human involvement, right? And since this is not happening, we are not inventing. But this, because of the pressures that are being imposed on us, I think this has to change. And I see that change coming slowly. There are many reasons. There are certain problems which are inherent to this country. You will not probably find that there are deaths in other nations. Why? Because you are employing a human to go inside a sewer and clean it. And this is something that you see happening quite regularly, even in our capital city. Or because some manhole covers were stolen, you find lives being lost. This is unacceptable in 21st century. And these can only be solved when you, who are the citizens of this country, do something about it, right? And some people say, oh, let's go and, you know, work in the most comfortable environments, and then we will send some inventions back to this country. I think this is unacceptable, because this is like very parallel to say, I want some fruit, the invention is like a fruit, let me plant a tree abroad and let somebody send these fruit to me whenever I want. I don't want that fruit. I want the tree planted right in my backyard, because when I have that tree in my backyard, that tree prevents soil erosion, it purifies the air, it gives me shade, it gives me these seeds, and eventually it also gives me fruit. So if you stay here and invent, you are not only going to invent something, you are going to create an ecosystem which will benefit the entire society in more than one ways, right? Now, to be able to invent, what all should you be doing? You should learn to work with your own hands. This is very alien to us. We employ, you know, people for trivial jobs. We have to stop doing that at some point of time. And we see actually societal pressures, you know, ganging up against this habit of ours. You see, there's so much disparity, and there's so much because of democracy and voices rising. I would not be surprised if in few years you find that suddenly the maid salaries are 10 times, making it impossible for common people to afford them, and therefore naturally you would have to create some solutions, right? So you had to start learning to do things with your own hands, which in common usage this is called tinkering. And second is to learn programming. Why should you learn programming? Because these days any device, any invention, any gadget that you see is actually a merger of three things: mechanical engineering, electronics, and programming. And people are even saying, oh, beyond programming, artificial intelligence, and so on and so forth, right? So programming, mechanical engineering comes naturally to most of us. We work with things, and so that's okay. Electronics and computing is something which is alien, and I like to, you know, lower that mental block with whoever I meet, and I say that learning to program is not very different from cooking. In cooking, you essentially work with three things. You start with ingredients, then you process that ingredient by cutting it, chopping it, grating it, or whatever is the requirement, and then you follow a certain procedure. Follow a certain process to cook whatever you want. Programming is exactly like that. In your program, you have variables which store your data. Then you process those variables, you process that data by adding, multiplying, you know, mathematical operations, and all these are done in a certain sequence. And you see, this is no very different from the art of cooking. And so if you understand cooking and you think this is okay, I think you can be a good programmer too. So you need to learn programming, you need to tinker with your hands. And if you do all this and you tried applying all these basic things to problems that you see around yourself, I would not be surprised that we start inventing for ourselves. How does the ecosystem help me do that? This whole democratization of access, as I call it, that because of the internet, because of the you know, digital banking, today I may be in a rural area, I may be otherwise disconnected physically, I am still connected in a virtual way. And so I can have access to all the things that are required to invent something, all the tools, repository of knowledge through the internet. And so I'm not far away from the rest of the world. Secondly, what is happening is the government of India is also alive to this situation. They have recently started a program called Atal Tinkering Lab, where they want, you see, if I teach grown-ups about tinkering, probably it's going to go waste. And the best way to, you know, imbibe something, best way to seed something is at a formative years in the school. And so this Atal Tinkering Lab is a program where Government of India is giving 20 lakh rupees to selected schools to start a tinkering lab. They expect the school only to provide about 1500, 2000 square feet of area. And there is a inventory which consists of, you know, electronic components, embedded computers, 3D printers and such, and they want the schools to let all their students be exposed to this whole tools of tinkering. And given the access to internet, I think kids would naturally use those tools and come up with some interesting stuff. This is going to change things a lot. And now, you might say, okay, I'm talking about invention. Why am I an educator and not a full-time inventor? And the answer is that if I were to be an inventor, you would get one inventor. But if I am an educator who thinks about invention, I could influence hundreds of students to enthuse them and to encourage them to be inventors. That is one. Secondly, I talked about this toy, right? So the problem of India is not that we as a nation cannot do things. The problem is that we don't think we can do it. And it is the responsibility of teachers like me to convince our generation, younger generation, that we can do it. And here is the made in my lab version of the same toy. It doesn't talk, it doesn't walk. That little thing walks also. When you leave it on a table, it will walk while it is speaking. This one does what it does, the speaking part, and it does something more. I'll give you a small demo here. Hello, let us see, where are you today? Say hello to the audience.
Hello, let us see, where are you today? Say hello to the audience.
And apart from that, it also has an alien mode in which it will record whatever you are speaking and will speak back as if a Martian was speaking. Hello, let us see where we are and say hello to the audience. And so I'm confident that, you know, I'm surrounded by young people who, given the push, shove, or whatever it takes, together with the tools, it is possible for this country to invent and make the life of all Indians, you know, more enjoyable, fruitful, and happy. And thank you for listening to me.